2022 of the Criminal Justice Committee. There are no apologies this morning. Please can I ask members to ensure that mobile phones are switched to silent and wait for the sound engineer to switch on your microphone before speaking. So our first agenda item today is consideration of the Prisons and Young Offenders Institutions Scotland Amendment Rules of 2021, and I refer members to paper one. Now, we took evidence on this last week from the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans and from the Scottish Prison Service. And I think we all recognise the balance that needs to be struck between a desire to prevent drugs entering our prisons while at the same time protecting the rights of prisoners. So before I ask whether the committee wishes to report any conclusions to the Parliament, I invite comments from members. So if anybody would like to make a comment, if you please either raise your hand or put an R in the chat function. Russell.
Yes, hello. I think it's worth just revisiting very, very quickly some of what brought us to this situation. You know, we had multiple ambulances getting called out to prisons at a time when the NHS was under severe strain. In particular, in Lanarkshire, it was at this level black, and these prisoners who had overdosed were being treated in intensive care beds in a hospital that was under severe pressure due to COVID. The ambulance service at this point was subject to assistance from the military, and the prison officers who have been talking about this drugs problem for many months and years, were many of them were saying this, the level of drugs were the highest they had ever seen in decades. And I think it's just worth reiterating that the need to do something with the Mayo, given it was the main source of drugs into the prisons, was absolutely vital and necessary and should be welcomed. And for all that, that there are issues around prisoners' rights, I think we also need to bear in mind the rights of prison officers and the working environment they're in. And indeed, the majority of prisoners who want to be in an environment that is not awash with drugs, and they are not susceptible to falling victim to that culture. So all in, it's a very important and positive development.
Okay, thank you very much, Russell. I'll hand over to Pauline. Pauline McNeill, I think you'd like to come in.
Thank you very much, Convener. I largely agree with the comments of Russell Findlay that we need to take proportionate action to roll back the scourge of drugs in our prisons. So I'm content that the regulations are necessary. I did raise, as other members did, concerns with the Cabinet Secretary and the Chief Executive of the Prison Service, Theresa Medway, just some reassurances around those prisoners who might innocently get caught up in this and questioned. What I felt satisfied about was that prisoners would be present if any suspect male was to go through this process, and that gave me some assurances. I just thought it would be useful to put on the record, Convener, that Miscarriages of Justice organisation Mojo have written to the committee expressing concerns they act on behalf of convicted prisoners where they feel there's a credible case, and they had. So I think it's maybe important just to note that correspondence, and I think certainly I for one will be listening out and monitoring the impact of these regulations to make sure that they actually are proportionate. And one of the concerns raised by families outside was that families may stop writing to prisoners because of fear that something untoward would happen to their correspondence, birthday cards or whatever, where they innocently sent them. So I think for those reasons, I think the committee just want to keep an eye on this going forward. But thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you very much, Pauline. I'll bring in Jamie Green, followed by Katie Clark. Jamie, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Good morning, committee members. I had three brief points to make. The first is in relation to the evidence that we took last week. I did feel at the end of it, we were perhaps none the wiser as to the scale and volume of mail that is being intercepted. There were a number of points raised, I think, which would merit some follow-up, perhaps in writing, from either the Scottish Prison Service or the Cabinet Secretary, primarily around the issue of the process of mail being intercepted. I think there's maybe some miscommunication or confusion in the wider public sphere around what mail is being stopped, what mail is not being passed to prisoners, what mail has been photocopied, what mail is or is not being read, and the process around that, where it takes place, who does it. And I just think there's maybe, I think maybe that transparency would help perhaps offer some reassurance to the families of those in prison, but also those who are not quite aware of what this SASI actually means and does in real life. I do appreciate there may be operational reasons why some information may be sensitive to share in public, and I think that was hinted at last week by the Cabinet Secretary. I'm fine and content with that, and I understand the reasons for that, but in that respect, perhaps that may be something that could be shared confidentially with members of the committee, as is the norm with such information. The second point was around the issue I raised that it's not just physical paper mail, paper and card, which is soaked in illicit substances. We know that other items are brought in, and the question really is if serious organised criminal gangs are now no longer to rely on traditional forms of smuggling drugs in through paper, how else will the drugs get into prison? I think it would be naive to think that it's just simply going to stop altogether. We know, for example, in the past, items of clothing which are sent to prisoners or other parcels are pre-soaked in drugs. And we also know that over the border and perimeter methods, the old-fashioned ways, if you like, are starting perhaps to see a resurgence as well. So I'd be very keen if the government and the SPS would keep us posted on that. And the third and final point was around an issue that I tried to raise but we ran out of time, around digital communication and what alternatives are being offered in terms of email systems. And I don't mean mobile telephony, but perhaps fixed devices or other forms of electronic communication that will allow families to privately, directly, confidentially, quickly and easily communicate with their loved ones who are in prison. And we didn't get a chance to really talk about that in great detail. So I would maybe perhaps appreciate an update on those as well.
Okay, thank you very much, Jamie. That's helpful. I'll move on to Katie Clark and then bring in Fulton McGregor. So over to you, Katie.
Which is very sad. It is, however, very important that they're implemented in a sympathetic way, particularly in relation to items of sentimental value. And I think that's something that the committee would want to keep being advised on and would need to satisfy itself that the regulations are being implemented in a way that are sympathetic to, you know, individuals that are incarcerated, that are cut off from their families. And, obviously the contact from families and the contact from children in particular is incredibly important to that individual. So I think the committee is very concerned about that aspect. And I think we would want to be kept, you know, closely advised on how that's being implemented, and in particular to be informed if there were problems and if it wasn't working in the way that we had understood that it was. So I think it's something that the committee will be monitoring. We did have a very full discussion and, I think privately all the committee members expressed concerns that would be the way that we would expect it to be implemented. More generally, I think the committee feels that it needs more information in terms of the scale of drugs in prisons. And I hope that over the coming period that will be shared with us, along with, you know, the information about how these regulations will be implemented, because as has been said, this is obviously only one route that's being used to bring drugs into prison, and it's a far larger problem than, you know, simply mail. And that's something I think the committee would want to hear more on and would expect the Scottish Government and the Scottish Prison Service to provide information to us on in the coming period.
Thanks very much, Katie. And finally, I'll hand over to Fulton and then I'll make a few comments myself.
Thanks, Convener. I probably agree with what the others have said today. I think that last week's evidence session on this was really quite useful. I think it's good to hear that our measures came in, and there does seem to be some evidence of initial early success with it. And obviously, we all want to make sure that drugs aren't getting into prisons. And I think Russell Finlay articulated it at the start. You know, obviously the often the consequences of that, both as the impact on the individuals and on the health service at this time. So, if a measure is even seen to be, you know, making progress in that area, I think it's incumbent on us to support it. We, as others have said as well, I did have concerns. I probably had more concerns before the evidence session last week, but I felt quite reassured listening to the Cabinet Secretary and Theresa Medhurst in terms of, you know, just how some of the mail would be used. I think there was quite a clear indication from the prison service that, that, you know, the mail, the private mail can't be read as such, and that there is safeguards in place. But nonetheless, all that said, I think that it's something that is very early, and it's probably a broad enough measure that it's got potential to be implemented in different ways across the sector. And for that reason, I would quite like to review it as well, but very happy to support it at this point, and as it seems to be making an initial difference. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Fulton. And I thank all the members for your comments. I think they're very balanced, they're measured, and set out our kind of thoughts on the evidence that we heard and some of the aspects of this SSI that we would like to monitor and follow up. I think it is important to Russell Finlay mentioned to or alluded to the issue around looking at this in the context of both prisoners and prison staff, and I think that based on the evidence that we heard last week, I was fairly reassured by what we heard, given that the process had been introduced in relatively quick time. I also feel that we perhaps would benefit from some more information on the practicalities of the process of monitoring mail and testing it. And really this comes down to ensuring that there is proportionality in the practice that prison officers are going to be involved in terms of monitoring mail. Just to say that we have written to the Scottish Prison Service Police Scotland in terms of their response when psychoactive substances are found, and also the Cabinet Secretary with some additional questions that we identified during last week's session. I completely agree with Katie's comment around the sentimental value of correspondence and the need for careful consideration of how that is handled and managed. Jamie Green made a very relevant point about other options around correspondence and communication, and I think we included some questioning around that in some of our follow-up letters. We are more than happy for us to publish our responses, and of course we will monitor and review this matter going forward. So on that basis, and the basis of members' comments, are we content that we have no further recommendations to make on the SSI and the evidence that we heard? No, agreed? Perfect. Thank you very much for that. And just before we move on, I would again like to thank all the witnesses who contributed to our evidence session with written submissions, the Scottish Centre for Criminal Justice Research, families outside, and as Pauline McNeill alluded to, the Miscarriage of Justice organisation for their submissions. They were really very helpful for us, so we very much appreciate your support in that. Okay, thank you for that. Our next agenda item is consideration of the Scottish Government response to the committee's pre-budget scrutiny report, and I refer members to paper 2. And I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans for his detailed response. So I'd just like to invite members to share any views or follow-up action that they would like the committee to take forward in response to the Cabinet Secretary's reply. So I'll just open it up at this point. No, I'm not seeing any hands or anybody wanting to speak. Okay, I'll bring in, I think we've got Russell, and then I'll bring in Pauline McNeill, and I think I saw Fulton McGregor's hand go up. So Russell, over to you.
Yes, thank you. There's quite a lot to go at, so I won't talk about everything that has jumped out at me. I'm sure others will come in, and perhaps at the end, if I've missed anything, I could revisit if there's time. But the Cabinet Secretary makes a reference to the Drugs Death Task Force. It's not clear from the papers whether his reply to the committee predates the resignation of the task force chair and deputy chair, which happened over Christmas New Year period. But what these two individuals said is that the Scottish Government's approach is counterproductive and driven by meeting targets rather than sustainable change. And I think that is clearly of significant concern to anyone who's got an interest in our record drugs deaths levels. And I just think it's important that we, you know, pay some attention to what they are saying and work out what has gone wrong, because clearly something has gone wrong here. Just one other point I'll make, if it's okay, it's in relation to fatal accident inquiries. The response from the Cabinet Secretary, on the one hand, says we are not complacent, but seems to simultaneously suggest that the system works. This is point 177 in the papers. It clearly isn't working. There's huge and growing backlog. Some of that's to do with COVID, but not all of it. Many of these cases are lasting for years, and the pain that's causing to families who have lost someone is just horrific. So I don't see how the not being complacent comment sits with the apparent position of everything actually being okay. So that's just, and I'll leave those two points just now, and then let someone else come in.
Okay, thanks very much. I'll move on to Pauline McNeill, and then I'll bring in Rona Mackay. Pauline, over to you.
Hey, thank you, convener. First of all, I'll follow on from the point that Finlay made earlier about the report on, with reference to fatal accident inquiries. So, I mean, I think there's a lot to welcome, let me say that. But these are just a few points that I do think need further investigation or amplification. I mean, actually, I'm surprised the Cabinet Secretary thinks that the current system related to deaths in custody represents the right model for the future. I mean, given the extraordinary length of time that families are waiting, it just seems to me there's a big piece of work be needed here by the Scottish Government and some investment. I also don't fully understand what the relationship between that then is and the recent statement where deaths in custody would be investigated independently, where we heard that powers would be given to ensure that those tasks could go on with the job on, I think it says, on no barriers, you know, unfettered access to get to the bottom of deaths in custody, given that we've had an extraordinary number of deaths in custody and a lot of families really concerned about the length of time. So I don't, I suppose I share Russell's comments in relation to there seems to be a bit of complacency there, and I would have thought Paul Hatton needs to be some investment attached to that. Secondly, in relation to the question of victims, implementation of the specific measures in Victims and Witnesses Scotland 2014 Act, such as victims being offered support when making a statement, it seems to be a theme for this committee in exploring whether or not there should be more formal support for victims in the system, either to be legally represented or more supported. So I think that's, for me, for further investigation on that one. And just lastly, I mean, the government's excellent work on violence against women and girls, I mean, it's a comprehensive programme. What I'd like to see is the investment going forward and how to ensure that the action plan is sustainable with achievements along the way. And point I've made in Parliament a number of times, I think there's some cross-cutting issues with justice and, well, I imagine it'd be equalities in relation to attitudes and violence against women and girls, where we've seen high levels of sexual harassment towards girls at a very young age, and some, I think we discussed in some of the, you know, some of the private sessions, some concerns about issues such as rape culture, and issues which are social issues. So I'd like to see some cross-cutting investment on between justice and the other departments that have an obvious interest in that. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Pauline. I'll bring in Rona Mackay and then Colette Stevenson. Rona.
Thanks, convener. Just a couple of points. I'll sort of go backwards and agree with Pauline on the violence against women and girls issue. I would like to see more cross-cutting between committees taking place, and because it's a huge subject, and I think it's one that we need to keep pursuing and really tackling it head on. So I agree with Pauline's comments. I won't repeat them all, but I agree with all of that. On the FAI question, I mean, I think, clearly there have been serious issues, and there are issues, and families have concerns. However, the Cabinet Secretary's response was that they're taking note of the recent death in custody report, and he has made an extensive statement in the chamber about this, etc. But I mean, I think, you know, to acknowledge the the seriousness, I think maybe, you know, it's obviously up to you, convener, but, you know, maybe a letter just to drill in a wee bit further on that issue. But I mean, I think the fact that the death in custody report, which was you know, excellent and all encompassing, is being considered, is a good thing. But we probably do need a bit more reassurance on that one. On the drugs death task force that Russell talked about, I completely disagree with him that there's any point in us going over that again. The two members who left, it's all been, you know, it was made public. I see no merit in us drilling back into that. Certainly acknowledging the work that they've been involved in is fine, but I don't see that would move us forward in any way, and I'm not sure that there is a great deal of public interest. I think what the public want now is just to move on and get things done. So that's my opinion on that one. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Rona. I'll bring in Colette and then Jamie Green. Colette.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, committee. I wanted to touch upon the FAIs, and one of the things that I had actually picked up on was that there had been issues in the past with the procurement contract with regards with pathology and toxicology. And Audit Scotland raised that as well during their annual audit report. And I actually took some comfort from the previous committee meeting that we had with the Lord Advocate, that in that they said there was a new contract brought out, which I think might reduce the length of times that some of these FAIs are actually taking place. And also just to note as well that it has obviously been a big issue as well during the pandemic, where strain on the NHS as well. So I really just wanted to note that as well. Thanks, convener.
Okay, thank you very much, Colette. I'll bring in Jamie, and then I will bring in Russell. I see you'd like to come back in, and then I'll make some final comments. So, Jamie.
Thank you, convener. I'll try and rattle through these, and if it's helpful, I will identify them in relativity to the committee's conclusions by number. So I'll start with 139. This is in response to the overall budget. The Cabinet Secretary responds that there will be a 7% increase in the portfolio's resource budget, but it's unclear if or what any increase in capital budget will be from that response. And that is important because it comes up later in some of our recommendations. In response to prisons and prison reform, there is an increase of £15 million to the SPS resource budget. It's unclear where that money is going or what it's for. Is it staff? Is it other forms of people-related expenditure rather than things? And the £73 million capital funding is merely an extension of existing commitments, so it will enable the conclusion of construction of female custodial estate and completion of other pieces of work, such as Inverness and Barlinnie, which we know, for example, may already be going over budget. So that doesn't seem to be new money, and I mention that because point 162 says there's no increase in the capital budgets for either Police Scotland or the SFRS either. So it seems to me that the only capital money that's mentioned is money that we already knew about in that respect. So that, for example, will not cover anything that goes towards investment in HMP Greenock or Dumfries. And that doesn't necessarily mean complete replacements. It could just be necessary infrastructure upgrades as per the recommendations of Her Majesty's Inspectorate. I would say in relativity to 162 in the police capital budget, it was very clear from the evidence given to us, not just by the police, but by other stakeholders, including the Federation, that there would be an absolute necessity for increased capital for essential modernisation, but not just cherry-picking upgrades, but things that actually would be necessary to allow police to continue in their duties. It seems to be that there's nothing in there for digital ICT, for fleet, for police estate, and indeed the greening or net zero targets of the police either, which is noted. So again, we also heard, for example, from Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, at least from their union, if nothing else, that some of the fire estate is not fit for purpose. There is a £9.5 million mentioned of modernisation, but I'm not quite sure where that £9.5 million is going. And it certainly doesn't seem to scratch the surface of probably what is needed. Now, these aren't necessarily criticisms, they're just observations of the responses. The point 173 was about the National Community Justice Strategy. It just says in response that it's under development and it will launch this year, but it doesn't mention what budget will be allocated, because we made a very specific ask that it should be adequately funded. And I note that no response was given to that. And probably the other major area of contention from my point of view was around legal aid. The committee took a lot of evidence on that issue, and I appreciate some of it is a matter of disagreement between various stakeholders. I do accept that. But we made it very clear that the profession, if nothing else, were clear that the government had failed to address issues around fees and negotiations around that. The one line answer was that the government does not accept that position. And then it then went on not to respond to points 182 or 184, which also include a very helpful suggestion around public defence solicitors, which I thought came from other members as we went through the process. And the government simply replies by saying no response is provided. And in my view, that's just not good enough. Same for 182 as well. Again, on the issue of tackling drug deaths, disappointing to read in points 189 and 191 that the government has refused to respond. We made a specific recommendation for a modest injection of funds, or for example, into recovery clinics and prisons, where we talked about that already in committee this morning, residential rehab and community day centres, and also a bit of clarification as to how all these budgets work together, because we know this is a drugs death crisis, is one that crosses many portfolios, and the government's response to both of those was simply no responses provided, which I think, given the gravity of the situation, again, is disappointing. So these are perhaps issues we may want to at some point in reflection of the budget process look back on, or indeed push the government further on. Thank you for your time, Convener.
Okay, thanks very much, Jamie. Russell, I think you want to come in, and then I'll come in after you.
Yes, thank you. So in respect of what Jamie said, I was going to raise a couple of these points, so that's good that you did. PDSOs, yes, indeed, we asked about this, but didn't get any kind of response. But going back to the Drugs Death Task Force, now we all know that 1,339 people in Scotland died last year from drugs. This task force has the job of doing something about that. The head and so the chairman and the deputy chair, both of whom are credible and eminent people, have quit. Now, I don't think we know enough about that, and I know that there's perhaps a tendency to want to move along, but I think if we put our fingers in our ears and don't explore this further, it sends out a pretty bad signal. What we do know, just by virtue of what's been in the media, is that these two individuals believe that the direction of travel is counterproductive. This is pretty fundamental. It's counterproductive to doing something about the drugs death toll. And I think it would be amiss of us not to explore this further.
Okay, thank you very much, Russell. Thanks, members, for your comments. Obviously, there's a lot in there. Some of the issues that have been raised, I would agree with, in particular around the question that Jamie raised about the capital budget, in particular for policing. That there's a lot in there. Also, the issues around FAIs and deaths in custody, which I think we all acknowledge and agree. There has been a lot of work and progress made around that, but an issue that we need to monitor and keep an eye on. What I would propose is, in response to the points that you have made, we can consolidate them, and really it would also be a question of whether or not we want to follow this up with some correspondence with the Cabinet Secretary for clarity on the points that have been made, or whether we are content with the reply that he previously provided. So I just open that question up again if members want to agree some follow-up correspondence with the Cabinet Secretary. Jamie, I see you had your hand up.
Thank you. Yeah, I think I sort of alluded to this. I think where, for example, on the issue, for example, of legal aid, where the government simply responds and says, with respect, we disagree, I think that's fine. They are entirely within their rights to either disagree with stakeholders who've given evidence, or the recommendations or the summary of the committee. It's entirely appropriate for the government to disagree with committees and their findings. That is common, and I don't have a problem with that. But where they have not answered a question at all on very important issues, then I would push back simply, uncontroversially, and say, with respect, Cabinet Secretary, the committee made a recommendation. And just to say that no response has been provided simply isn't good enough. If the response comes further back and says it's not possible, or I disagree, or whatever, that's fine. That is, that is a response, but no response is not a response. So, and I would be minded to, on those issues, to push back. It is also worth noting, though, however, this is just a draft budget. So, you know, the budget will go through its iterative process, and the political parties and their spokespeople are within their rights to press the government for more money on whatever they want. And that will form part of those negotiations. So, you know, there may be other opportunities in which we can do some of this as a committee and revisit it as it goes through the process. And certainly by the time we get to the final stages of the budget, we will know what the final numbers are, because it's not necessarily a given that what's been presented to us are the final numbers. And I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary has the wherewithal to request for as much as he thinks is needed from his colleagues in government, so off the back of the committee's recommendations. So perhaps we could ensure that we schedule in some opportunity in the future for the committee to review later iterations of the numbers to see if it perhaps meets us some way in some of our asks.
Thanks, Jamie. Katie Clark, I see you'd like to come in. Over to you.
Yes, thank you very much. In terms of the correspondence in response to the Cabinet Secretary, I think it is important that we do push on the deaths in custody issue. But the other issue that I think it would be useful to ask about is a lot of the evidence that we've taken and the discussion we've had around about how sexual offences and domestic abuse are dealt with and how that relates to the budget, and particularly the new budget strategy. It may well be that any financial implications of the implementation of any measures that are necessary would be dealt with in the new justice strategy. I'm not sure, but it does seem to me that if they're talking about significant changes going forward in terms of how sexual offences and violence against women and girls are dealt with, there must be financial implications of that. So it might be quite useful to, you know, use the correspondence to see if we can get some more detail on that in terms of what the thinking is.
Okay, thanks very much. Thank you for those follow-up comments. At the moment, my thought would be, and I'll ask members for agreement on this, is Jamie's point about, you know, that we are at the sort of draft budget point at the moment. What I would propose is that we, obviously, some of the issues that we feel quite strongly about are ones that I've no doubt we will come back to, certainly within our work programme going forward. And in that regard, I would propose that as we work through our work programme, that gives us an opportunity to monitor budgetary issues and aspects of the work that we're looking at. And where there are issues that come up around this particular topic, we can raise them at that point and in the appropriate way. Are members in agreement with that? Anybody not in agreement? Okay. Finally, I'd just like to just pick up on the point that Russell Finlay were making in relation to the task force and the recent resignations. I do understand where you're coming from with that. I'm not sure that's necessarily directly a budgetary issue, but I'm sure that we will have some further discussion about that in the context of the issue that you raised just a few moments ago. So if we're content to not issue any further correspondence to the Cabinet Secretary in line with the budget response that he provided us with, I'll bring this agenda item to a close and thank you all for your comments and contributions, and we'll now move into private session, and that concludes the public part of this meeting. And our next meeting will be on Wednesday the 26th of January, and we'll now move into private session and move on to MS Teams. Thank you.